Good evening. My name is Mike Ross. I'm president of Voice for Israel, and I want to welcome you to today's exciting program. As you may know, Voice for Israel was established 11 years ago with the mission to advocate and educate for Israel. And we are delighted to be able to bring to you today's distinguished speaker, Dr. Jonathan Shanzer. This program was made possible by the vision of our good friends, Mark and Susan Goldhaber, who first initiated the idea for having a webinar with Dr. Shanzer 8 weeks ago. We had no idea what would ensue in the next several months, but the playing field in the Middle East has really changed in the last 2 months, and so has our program. But Dr. Shanzer is an ideal analyst and expert in the field to help us make sense of what has been happening. We wish to acknowledge our partners for today's webinar, Stand With Us, the Jewish Federation of Durham Chapel Hill, the Raleigh Cary Jewish Community Relations Council. I want to thank you all. I also want to remind our viewers that Voice for Israel will be partnering with the Jewish National Fund for a Zoom program on September 13th entitled No One Left Behind, Integrating Those with Special Needs into the IDF. We will include a link to register for that event on our follow-up email to all attendees of today's program. If you would like to receive our Voice for Israel emails to be updated about our programming and issues related to Israel and the welfare of Jewish people, with an emphasis on local concerns, please sign up at our website, voiceforisrael.com. I am going to be interviewing Dr. Shanzer for approximately 30 minutes, and then we will open it up to you, the audience, for a Q&A. To pose your question, just click on the Q&A link at the bottom right of your screen and type your question in. Marcia Harris, who is waiting in the wings, will then read the questions to our guest. Middle East analyst Jonathan Shanzer is Vice President of Research for the Foundation for Defense of Democracies. Previously, he has served as a counterterrorism analyst at the U.S. Department of the Treasury. He was also a research fellow at the Washington Institute. He holds a BA from Emory University, a master's degree from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, and a doctorate from King's College London. He is the author of three highly acclaimed books, including Al-Qaeda's Armies, Hamas versus Fatah, The Struggle for Palestine, and State of Failure, Yasser Arafat, Mahmoud Abbas, and the Unmasking of the Palestinian State. He publishes widely in the national press, has testified before Congress, and makes frequent appearances on TV. He is fluent in Arabic and Hebrew. He has traveled throughout the Middle East. He is a very sought after guest speaker, and we are so very fortunate and delighted to have him with us today. Thank you, Jonathan.
Pleasure.
Let me make sure you're on the screen. There you are. So I wanted to first talk to you about the place that you work, the Foundation for Defense of Democracy. What do you do there? What's its mission? And what are the main issues that it addresses?
Sure. First of all, Mike, thank you so much for the opportunity to speak with your community tonight. I have to say these are obviously challenging times, but it really is a pleasure to continue to work with various communities that support the State of Israel, that support America's interests in the Middle East. And so thanks again for having me tonight. FDD is a think tank in Washington. Think tanks are, I don't want to say they're a unique Washington phenomenon, but that's where most of them are located. My organization is made up of a lot of former government officials, academics, linguists, people that have spent a lot of time in the Middle East or in other parts of the world that are relevant to U.S. national security. Myself, I'm a former terrorism finance analyst at the Treasury Department. I've got colleagues that are former CIA, former White House, NSC, and everybody works together to try to basically help the U.S. government get out of its own way. As you may have heard, the U.S. government can be overly bureaucratic. It can be a little rigid from time to time. It can be less than creative. And so what we do is, you know, we operate without those restrictions and without that kind of cumbersome bureaucracy. So we're the guys that you'll often see in the press writing articles in the Wall Street Journal or the Washington Post or appearing on CNN or Fox. and talking about the ways that Americans should interpret the news, whether it's Arab-Israeli peace, whether it's ISIS, Al-Qaeda, Iran, North Korea, China, all of these things are kind of in our bailiwick. And I'm the director of research, so I have the honor of overseeing a lot of very smart people who have a lot of really fascinating ideas. My problem is I just don't sleep very much because there's always something that's going on in the world.
Well, there has been a lot lately, and last week we were all stunned by the announcement that the UAE and Israel were formalizing diplomatic ties. In fact, I was going to ask you whether you could ever foresee such a thing happening, but that question is moot now. Last night I was talking to some friends of mine, and they asked me, what drove us to this point? What drove the two parties to get together? And I flippantly said it was because of Iran and the nuclear deal, and they both saw the threat that Iran posed to them, that is Sunni Arab states and Israel. But that was kind of a too simple an answer. What do you think were the main drivers of this agreement?
Well, Mike, I actually would say that I do think that the Iran nuclear deal had a lot to do with it. The United States back then did not consult with our Arab partners and began to provide billions of dollars in sanctions relief to the Iranians. And there were sunsets. In fact, one is coming up in the next month. And that's the sunset on the arms embargo. And within 5 years of signing the deal, it meant that Iran would be able to buy and sell weapons on the open market. And this was something that not just Israel was unhappy about, but the Arab world was unhappy about it. And the Arabs basically were looking around for anyone who might be able to help them in countering Iran. And of course, as we know, there's one country in the region that's quite good at countering Iran, whether it be through financial means or military means or tangling with some of Iran's proxies. This, is I think the main reason why the Arabs sought out the Israelis, and the Israelis, of course, welcomed this with open arms. But it wasn't only the Iran deal. I would say maybe two other things that are worth noting. One is the Arab Spring. Of 2011, you remember this was when governments were rising up all around the region, overthrowing or at least challenging the existing order. We had the rise of the Muslim Brotherhood. Muslim Brotherhood is an organization that typically doesn't like to celebrate Hanukkah in Tel Aviv, and also has it out for the Arab states. They would like to overthrow the existing order in Saudi Arabia or UAE or Bahrain. Not to mention Morocco, Jordan, and beyond. So even as early as 2011, you got a sense that the Arab states and Israel had a lot to talk about. And there was a lot of concern, yet again, about where the U.S. was heading, given that the U.S. was engaging with the Muslim Brotherhood as part of the solution, not part of the problem. But I would say there's probably one other thing to note here, and that is that Israel outlasted these countries in a battle of wills. These countries all believed that the Arab boycott would ultimately undermine Israel economically. They thought that the various wars that were launched by the Arab states would ultimately wound or even kill Israel. And what Israel did is, over 70 years, it proved them wrong time and again. And I would say that the old adage, if you can't beat them, join them, was probably, I don't know what the equivalent is that is in Arabic, and I'd like to learn it. But I think that was kind of something that they were thinking about, which is, why are we fighting with the Israelis? They're strong, they're resilient, they've got a great economy, they've got a great military, they have a lot of the same enemies that we have. Why are we doing this? And I think the realization was that, they went to war in the first place, or they declared their animosity to Israel because of the Palestinians. And I think that there was a realization probably since the Second Intifada, 2005, and then after that, where they kind of, looked around and said, maybe the Palestinian cause is not our cause any longer. And that, I think, that idea has really evolved over time. And the UAE was the first to formally acknowledge it in kind of this era. But my sense is there are probably about 3, 4, maybe even 5 countries that will follow because of similar sentiments.
So who would you say are the winners and the losers in this announcement?
Well,
who's upset? Who's mad? And who's going to try to challenge it and subvert it?
So, I mean, clearly the PLO is very angry. The Palestinian Authority, they feel like they've been sold out. Although it's interesting, even the PLO has dialed back a little bit on the voicing of their frustration, I think possibly because the UAE may have offered them some remuneration for, and I can't prove this, but, you know, one day the PLO was screaming and banging their heads against the wall, and the next minute they were like, oh, well, we, you know, we respect the decision of our Arab brothers. So it does raise the question of whether some agreement was struck on the side between the two. Turkey was very angry. Turkey is it's funny. I mean, they have a diplomatic relationship with Israel, of course. They've got an embassy in Tel Aviv, and they do a lot of trade with Israel. Turkish Airlines goes back and forth between Israel all the time. Israeli tourists are actually there right now because it's one of the countries that has a reciprocal tourism relationship with Israel. But yet, at the same time, the Erdogan government came out opposed and said they were actually considering cutting off their relations with the UAE for doing exactly what the Turks already do. So that was a bit strange, but you know, just consider it par for the course for Recep Tayyip Erdogan, the president of Turkey, who is, I would say, an unmitigated anti-Semite and really wields anti-Israel sentiment in the Muslim world for political reasons. The Qataris were probably not happy. They are also, like the Turks, they are supporters of the Muslim Brotherhood movement. And even though they have a relationship with Israel, they don't like Israel very much.
Al Jazeera is from Qatari, right? Al Jazeera is
that's okay. Right. And if you watched Al Jazeera over the last, you know, couple of days, they were going bananas over this. And of course, Al Jazeera and Qatar, you have to understand, they have the Qataris have a real rivalry with Saudi Arabia and the UAE. So they were using Al Jazeera as kind of a bludgeon, if you will, a cudgel to beat the Emiratis over the head for selling out the Palestinians. But the big loser here, I would say, is Iran, no question. You know, they were hoping rally the region against Israel. And clearly what you're seeing is a moderation of kind of the regional stance, and they look increasingly like outliers. And of course, again, the UAE really doesn't like Iran, and I think part of this stems from, you know, the outreach to Israel stemmed from their mutual animosity. I just saw a question come up in the chat about Hamas. I'll just say this: Hamas is clearly not happy about the UAE decision, but because the PLO looked so bad by this, Hamas was, I think, kind of happy. They looked like, well, you know, we always knew that something like this would happen. And it's just proof that the PLO is bad at what they do. So, you know, choose us next time. It's part of that intra-Palestinian rivalry that I've written a lot about over the years.
So is this going to be one of those historical events that we'll look back on and say this was a real game changer? Or is it going to be something that gets accommodated to and doesn't change that much? And what I'm really looking for, are the Palestinians at some time going to wake up that history is passing them by and it's time to make peace? Or are they going to continue to be recalcitrant after this? I guess that's two questions.
Yeah, I mean, look, what I would say is, and these are questions that we're all asking right now. I would say there are a couple of things to watch for without being able to, you know, predict anything. As the Israelis like to say, they don't like to predict anything in the Middle East, especially the future. I would agree with that. And what I would say is, number one, look for the domino effect. This could be the first of several dominoes to fall in the Arab world. The countries that we're watching right now are Morocco, Oman, Bahrain, Sudan, which is an amazing one because they are a state sponsor of terrorism right now, and they're trying to get off the terrorism list. They probably deserve it already. And they already have a relationship. Their president met with Netanyahu 6 months ago, and they've already been exploring this relationship. So that'll be a fascinating one. And then, of course, the last one would probably be Saudi. But I think the Saudis are probably going to be a little bit more careful. They want to wait and see what the domestic backlash might be in some of these other countries before they make their own decision. They're much more careful. It's a conservative society that's been fed a steady diet of anti-Israel, anti-Semitic sentiment. So they can't just do a 180 and expect the population to just say, oh, great, that sounds fun. So we'll watch for those things. Then there is the question of that, you know, has been actually an ongoing debate since we've been watching these ties develop. So really for the last, you know, 2 years or so, this question of peacemaking outside in versus inside out. And what I mean by that is right now, the U.S. appears to be pursuing the outside in approach, that you bring the Arab countries closer to Israel and broker some of these relationships. And then these Arab states can bring pressure to bear on the Palestinians and say, basically, guys, you know, you're going to miss the boat. Right, we're all making peace with Israel. You're the outlier here. Let me tell you what you need to do in order to get right with the United States and to get right with Israel and to get with the program, so to speak. And that the Israelis could use the relationship that they're building with the Arab states to make inroads with the Palestinians. And then the inside-out approach is what we've always done. And quite frankly, it's failed. I mean, if we're going to be honest about the traditional two-state paradigm and diplomacy, you know, we focus primarily on what the Palestinians want, what the Palestinians say they need, and we try to accommodate them, and they reject us time and again. And the Israelis walk away frustrated. The United States loses face and loses credibility on the world stage. So the question I think that people are asking now is whether the outside-in approach is the winner, or maybe there's a combination of both, right? You work the outside in and you work the inside out, and maybe eventually you kind of find that sweet spot. And that's my sense anyway, is that we're probably going to go that route, but with a primary focus right now on those Arab states that are eager to do this. Now, the one other thing that I would just mention is, you know, we're in the middle of a political season, and it's possible that obviously that Trump could win again, and then you'll have the continued pursuit of the outside-in approach. If Biden wins, you could see a complete overhaul of this approach. Now, I think right now, if you're in the Biden advisory team, you're probably saying to yourself, you know, Trump just got a win here, and there's five more wins to be had, and I smell a Nobel Prize. Right? That if you could get five more countries to go the way of the UAE, man, you have changed geopolitics for a long time, right? You've really, you know, you've reversed history in many ways. So there has got to be a real debate, I think, right now in the Biden camp, despite the fact that there are some in, let's call it the progressive wing of the Democratic Party that really wants to focus on, you know, justice for the Palestinians or punitive measures against Israel or BDS or all those things, you know, politically, it may not be as expedient as trying to develop these relationships with these Arab countries that are ripe for the picking. And so it's going to be a really interesting thing to see how the kind of foreign policy platform of Biden changes, especially if Trump can get another win or two under his belt before November.
So I'm going to shift a little bit to some of the issues that we're hearing about in Israel, that sort of relate to the politics in Israel. I mean, Bibi Netanyahu is a master politician. Some people think he's an incredible diplomat and he deserves tremendous credit. A lot of people resent him. But I know there's a couple issues that are connected to this decision. One is the issue of annexation. And did he backtrack? Is that a permanent backtrack? What are the implications to his coalition and to the politics? And also, there's stories going around about the F-35s that may or may not go to the UAE. I guess may be sold to the UAE by America. So what do you want to say about those subjects?
So, look, on the question of annexation, or as the Israelis like to put it more delicately, the application of sovereignty in roughly 30% of the West Bank, I think that's semantics, but you know, the Israelis would say you can't annex territory that never really belonged to anyone else, given the chain of custody in the West Bank. And I take that, but you know, from a practical perspective, we could call it annexation.
Yeah.
I was one of the few, well, maybe not few, but I was outspoken in kind of, let's just say, pro-Israel analyst circles, where I was saying it was a bad idea. It was a bad idea because it would create tension with the Democratic Party. It would create tension within elements of the Republican Party. It would create real problems with the Europeans, which the Israelis, look, the Europeans are lost in many ways, but the Israelis don't need more problems with the Europeans. And by the way, if the Europeans ended up engaging in punitive measures against Israel that could cut trade, you could imagine that the Israelis would have to go scramble to find new supply chains for certain products, and they would probably go to China, which then, of course, would set off the Republicans who've been more hawkish on China. So you can imagine all the mess that might come from this. And analytically, it just made zero sense to me. But the biggest thing that really didn't comport from my perspective was, look, you had all these Arab countries that I just mentioned, UAE, Saudi, Bahrain, Oman, you know, Morocco, Sudan. They're all lining up saying that they would like to work with Israel and maybe recognize Israel and maybe have peace with Israel. Why would you ruin that for something that is, at the end of the day, I mean, look, the Israelis already control that territory. Does it really matter whether you annex it? You know, at this moment, it just felt like it was, you know, my kids are still young. It's like in the cartoons where somebody steps on a rake and it pops them in the head and they keep doing it. This would be the equivalent of that from a foreign policy perspective. And I saw no reason to do it. And so I'm glad that they didn't. And of course, the Emiratis made this one of their demands as the kind of the predicate for engaging in this deal with Israel. My understanding is that Israel has agreed to hold off on this for 3 years. I think they should have said 10. I think they should have said 20. It would have bought a lot more goodwill. But look, then again, with annexation and with the West Bank, there is one thing that you can't deny, and that is that Israel's borders have been dangerous and in many ways unsustainable in years past. As Israel has become a stronger power with better technology and a stronger military, and the gap has really grown between Israel and its peers in the Middle East, I've been less concerned about what Abba Eman famously dubbed the Auschwitz borders. But look, that gap can always be lessened. And that's actually getting right to the question that you ask about the F-35, Mike, which is, you know, this is a high-tech piece. It's actually a computer in the shape of a jet airplane. It is so highly computerized and can do so many functions from the air. And it's able to, you know, it's got stealth functions and it's got the ability to launch high-tech weaponry, and it can detect enemies and allies near and far. It's a remarkable piece of machinery. It's still, they're working out the kinks, but you know, Israel has a lot to worry about when its enemies get a hold of something like this. And so, you know, you could get a sense why the Israelis would be ambivalent, to put it mildly, about this. I think they want to see where the UAE-Israel peace deal goes before agreeing to something like this. You know, the Turks have, or were part of the UAE supply chain, and the Turks are, you know, sponsors of Hamas and sponsors of Al-Qaeda and ISIS, and they help Iran engage in money laundering, and they call for violence against Israel. It would have been a disaster for the F-35 to continue to change hands and to arrive into Turkey. Thankfully, the U.S. has put the brakes on this, but this is the kind of thing that Israel, you know, Israeli defense planners, it keeps them up at night as they worry about these sorts of things getting into the wrong hands. the term, if you want to look it up, because everybody's on their computer and they can, it's QME is the acronym that we wield in Washington, Qualitative Military Edge. It is actually an American law passed thanks to, I'm sure, your organization, AIPAC, and a number of others that pushed for the United States government to always ensure that Israel had an edge over its enemies or even a coalition of its enemies in the Middle East. And QME is what's on the minds right now of Israel and the United States.
So let's shift to the other major news that came out. Well, it happened about a month ago now, the terrible, horrific explosion in Beirut. Lebanon was already a country that's pretty much a failed state. Their economy's in shambles. They have a crushing debt that I know you've written about. Their government and military and economy is partially controlled by the proxy Hezbollah. And then there's this horrific explosion. Who's shouldering the blame right now in the minds of Lebanese people? And what is Hezbollah in jeopardy of being toppled from its perch, or are they going to be able to overcome this setback?
Well, politically, Hezbollah has actually been toppled already because the government recently fell. It resigned amidst the protests of the Lebanese people who came out after this explosion and called for the fall of the government. The government fell, and the linchpin, the key political player, was in fact Hezbollah and its allies, and so they've lost power in a political sense. The problem is in Lebanon, they have a huge military, and right now they control something like 150,000 rockets that are facing south at Israel, and that's cause for real concern. Recently, there's also been a concern voiced by Israeli military officials about something called PGMs, precision guided munitions. These are very deadly rockets that Iran has been providing to Hezbollah. We think they have, I'm going to guess, around 300. It's not like they're, settling up with Ernst & Young every month to let everybody know what the latest number is. But these weapons are potentially able to evade Iron Dome, which is deeply troubling. So the Israelis wouldn't necessarily be able to shoot them down. And then also they have, because they have these evasive maneuvers and tactics that they're able to do. And then they also have the ability to hit something within 10 yards of the intended target. And that is incredibly precise. I mean, one of the reasons why Israel has thrived in even amidst multiple military campaigns against it is because most of the rockets fired by Israel's enemies, Hamas, Hezbollah, Pidge, et cetera, they're unguided. They're dumb rockets. These are smart rockets, guided rockets. And so the Israelis have been very, very concerned about this. And I would argue that Lebanon is closer to war with Israel than it has been since 2006. I would argue that a war could break out at any moment because of Israel's concern over this. And, they continue to issue warnings directly. They issue warnings through the United States, through the French, through the Europeans. And, it's unclear whether Hezbollah is doing anything to stop it. So you have this concern on top of the political instability that we just saw as a result of the blast. And then there's the economy, which you mentioned. Lebanon, under the influence of Hezbollah, has racked up, thanks to corruption, kleptocracy, illicit finance, terror finance, narco-terrorism, cooperation with drug dealers in Latin America to move money all around and then repatriate that cash. You've had banks that have been sanctioned by the U.S. Treasury. You've had U.S. banks begin to say, yeah, I don't think we can work with you. The international community is getting a little gun shy. And meanwhile, the International Monetary Fund is now grappling with the math over how much they are in debt. And that number, we hired an economist to try to zero in on that number. That number is astounding. That number is $93 billion. This is a country of 5 million people around the size of Delaware. And it has racked up more debt than, I mean, just for comparison, the largest bailout that the IMF has had to deal with to date has been Argentina. And that was $58 billion. And Lebanon is no Argentina. There's no exports. There's nothing. And so the country's in a lot of trouble. It's got a Hezbollah problem. It's got a political problem. It's got a military problem. I would argue that, you know, the explosion was kind of a symptom almost it sort of struck me as kind of a sneeze when the entire country has cancer. And it'll be really interesting to watch how the U.S. and others try to solve this. But the answer is not to bail it out. The answer is to try to ensure reform. And I'm not sure that the U.S. is focused in that way right now. We're dealing with Corona. We're dealing with our own political issues. The Middle East is perennially a mess. And you can't imagine that other countries are going to get in there. The Europeans, I don't think they've got the will. So Lebanon is one to watch.
So behind this, some of the messier parts of the Middle East is Iran, who they have a nuclear program that, with ambitions to be a nuclear military state, and they're a malign, destabilizing force. Have you been pretty happy with the policies that this administration has had towards Iran, and how would you critique at them, and what might we anticipate if Biden is in the presidency next January?
Look, I would say that I've been basically happy with the Iran policy of this administration. I think a lot of people are reluctant to give the president credit for much. And I know that this is an apolitical forum, so I'm not going to get into the politics of it, but I will just say that, even a broken clock can be right twice a day. And you can have some wins, even if you're unhappy with the overall trajectory of foreign policy or just America in general. And so I would argue that, the reversal of the Iran deal, and the decision to halt the appeasement of the world's most prolific state sponsor of terrorism was a good thing. I would quibble with how some of it was done. The pulling out of the deal with, my understanding was the Trump administration was trying to hammer out 5 or 6 different issues with the Europeans where they would come up with a new deal to offer the Iranians back in 2018. And they decided to just pull the plug on it when Trump had just kind of had enough. And I would criticize the Trump administration for that. But overall, the maximum pressure campaign, the debate right now about snapping back sanctions when Iran has very clearly violated the terms of the nuclear deal. To me, it makes a lot of sense to do this. A lot of people were thought that the assassination of Qasem Soleimani back in January was controversial. I have to say that it was probably more meaningful to me, or the most meaningful targeted assassination since we took out bin Laden, in terms of what it meant for Americans and saving American lives, and the amount of blood that this man had on his hands. Hundreds of Americans were killed by him and his henchmen in Iraq and in Afghanistan over the last decade, and it was beyond justified. So I would say that overall, I've been happy. I've had issues with the execution of some of the policies, but the policies themselves have been sound. And that, of course, raises questions about what happens next. What happens if Trump wins another term? You know, my sense is that the Iranians probably try to come to the table and negotiate. They've tried to outlast him. So have the Palestinians, for that matter. I mean, they're like fighters on the ropes, just trying to duck as many punches as they can, hoping that they can outlast Trump. If they see that Trump wins again, then they're going to probably have no choice but to talk. If Trump loses, then, there will be, I think, an opportunity for Biden to think about some kind of a new altered deal, a new altered arrangement? Because I would say that the Iran deal wasn't all bad. I took issue with a lot of what it was in it, but the idea of halting Iran's nuclear program made a lot of sense. It really did. The problem was all the things that Iran got in exchange, the hundreds of billions of dollars, the sunset provisions, the weapons that are coming to it in another month if we don't stop it. The fact that we didn't make an issue about terrorism or Hamas or Hezbollah or what's going on in Syria. We decided to be myopic, to really have blinders on with the nuclear issue only. And so my hope here is, and I don't think that the Trump administration will pursue this, but I do think that there are smart people in the Biden camp that would, where they might say, look, we understand that Iran, that you still want sanctions relief, and you know, we have maybe an obligation to look into this, but we have to address some of the other things that Israel and the Arab states are concerned about, and we're going to have to make this more of an all-encompassing deal than the original one, and we're going to demand that you do this or sanctions will be a reality for you. That's what I think should have been done the first time around, and I think Biden has a rare second chance, in pursuing this. And, I think there's a debate within the Biden camp about whether that's something that they want to pursue, but I know it's on the table and I welcome it.
Well, you have written, or I've heard you speak at a recent webinar about the fact that Iran is reeling from a lot of different factors. Crippling sanctions, an economy in free fall, inflation, the pandemic, and then these sort of explosions, which are, we're not sure where they came from. All this is, we who fear Iran are happy to see it under duress. What should be our ultimate goal? I mean, or is our ultimate goal for regime change? Or do we actually believe that Iran can reform itself?
Look, my sense is that this regime has a certain DNA, and it's not likely ever going to backtrack on what they call exporting the revolution. It's a radical Islamist Shiite ideology that is really hell-bent on the destruction of Israel and the destruction of the West. And I find it very hard to believe that that this regime would halt that activity. I do think that if forced to address the question of survival and curtailing a lot of this activity, it's possible that you'd be able to negotiate some kind of a deal where terrorism is off the table. You know, maybe the rhetoric doesn't stop, maybe the kind of radicalization in the region doesn't stop, but the violence itself maybe could be curtailed. But it's hard for me to buy that. I think this regime is already on a path, and it doesn't ever envision itself backing down. It talks about resistance, a resistance economy, political resistance, military resistance. So that's my sense. In terms of regime change, I'll just say this, that in Washington, regime change is like a dirty word now. It's two words, I know, but we're not supposed to say it because, Iraq was a disaster and Afghanistan was a disaster. And I think, the American military has shown that it's, not really particularly good at state building. I think we're good at kind of traditional military functions, kind of traditional war. I think America is still, a superpower. But when we start to try to build wells and schools and things like that, and our soldiers are asked to do that, I don't think that's their sweet spot. I don't think that's what they do well. I wouldn't endorse American regime change in the model that we have seen. Mm. I would say, though, that I'd welcome the collapse of the regime if it meant the empowerment of the Iranian people. The Iranian people are pro-America, they're pro-West. Most of them detest the regime that's in place. And if we could find a way without hurting the people and without depriving them beyond where they've already been deprived by their own regime, to empower them and to give them a path, I'd welcome it. I just, it's a tricky thing. It's not an easy thing. And of course, you know, America feels very snake bitten about this sort of stuff. And so it's not a conversation that you're often going to hear. I happen to be a guy that doesn't work for the US government, so I can talk about it freely, and won't get in trouble for it. But there are a lot of people who would say, you know, let's not say that.
All right. I have so many questions, but I'm hogging you. I'm going to turn it over to Marcia, because I think we have some questions from the audience. Marcia, can you start your video?
Yes, I'm here. Dr. Shanzer, thank you so very much for such valuable insights into really important issues. And Dr. Ross, thank you for doing such a wonderful job with asking the questions of Dr. Shanzer. So several of the questions that have come in have already been addressed. There are a few that are still on the topic of the UAE agreement, and let's start with those. So one of the questions is, what do you think that the Egyptians and the Jordanians feel about the agreement?
It's a great question, actually. So Egypt is, Egypt views UAE as a patron. You know, they take a lot of money from the UAE. The UAE and Egypt work very closely together to battle the Islamists in Libya. They have been working to challenge Turkey as it has been a bit aggressive in the Mediterranean in terms of gas drilling and things like that. So they're already, I think, very close. And my sense anyway is that Egypt welcomed this. You know, they certainly didn't have a veto. But if anything, my sense anyway is that if the UAE-Israel relationship is as warm as I think it will be, it could serve as a model to Egypt, which has been a traditionally cold peace. It's not. It's been pretty frigid. I mean, at the top, the CCBB romance, as a bromance, let's call it, has been. It's been great, right? But at a lower level, at a people-to-people level, it's not great. I mean, I remember, you know, this was a while ago, so I'll kind of date myself. But in the year 2001, I lived in Egypt after graduate school. And one of the number one songs on the radio in Arabic was Ana Bakrah Israel, I hate Israel. It literally was a song that people loved. It was top 10. And it resonated with the people. And that's the kind of stuff that you want to see changed. And I think the UAE could really, you know, I think serve as an example for Egypt. On Jordan, I actually think that the UAE deal, when history is written about this 5 years from now, 10 years from now, the UAE deal may have saved the Jordan-Israel relationship, saved the peace deal. The reason why is because Jordan was irate about Israel's possible annexation of 30% of the West Bank. The king had basically called out the Israelis and said that there would be grave ramifications and that the peace deal would be potentially in jeopardy. He was basically betting his position. He was betting his royalty on opposition to annexation. And then lo and behold, the UAE comes in, they swoop in and they say, all right, annexation's off the table. You don't need to worry about it anymore. We're making peace and the Israelis have decided they're not gonna do this. And now all of a sudden the Jordanians have a different tune that they're singing. And we understand that right now, senior Jordanian officials are in Ramallah and they're talking to the Palestinians about, you know, re-engaging with Israel and having a conversation regionally about some of the changes that may take place. So all of a sudden Jordan is playing the role that we want it to after really a long time of a lot of tension. Now, I don't want to oversell how great things are. I think that the tension is still there. It's just not as intense. You have to remember that Jordan is 85% Palestinian at this point. It's basically a Palestinian state. So the people do not like Israel. And so even if the king engages with Israel, the people are going to express their misgivings about it. And that's always going to be the dynamic. But right now, at least the Hashemite kingdom as such is back working with Israel. And that is terrific news.
Thank you. Three other countries that our audience is curious about relative to the UAE are Azerbaijan, Syria, and Russia.
So Azerbaijan is an interesting one. They, as folks probably know, they've been rumored anyway to be the place where when Israel stole those documents from the warehouse in Iran, those nuclear documents that were later exposed and quite frankly revealed some of the things that have come out recently about the Iran nuclear deal that have enabled the United States to talk about snapback on the sanctions front. Azerbaijan was apparently, or at least rumored to be, the place where the Israelis drove these documents across the border and then got into a C-130 that took them home, allegedly, right? No one talks about these things openly, but that's the rumor. So Azerbaijan is already a partner for Israel, a Shiite country that is kind of the polar opposite of Iran. An ally of the United States. And, I think we can expect to see more of the same with that relationship. Incidentally, it's funny, I just finished a book. I'm not sure how many people have done any reading or learning about a territory that's in Azerbaijan called Nagorno-Karabakh. It's an occupied territory occupied by Armenia. And I was reading this because, the world's focus seems to always be on one occupied territory. But nobody talks about BDS in Nagorno-Karabakh. Nobody talks about boycotting Armenia. It's just kind of a remarkable thing. And Azerbaijan is obviously the aggrieved party there. They're kind of the Palestinians, and they don't identify with the Palestinians. They don't take that same approach. And it's an interesting little chunk of history to look into if you find yourself bored during the quarantine. As for the other countries that you mentioned, Syria, look, it's going to remain what it is. It's unfortunate. It's right now the tide has turned in favor of the Assad regime. They have control there. They're working with Hezbollah. They're working with Iran. They're the transit point, by the way, for those precision-guided munitions that I mentioned. And it's one of the reasons why you continue to see things explode in the middle of the night. Sometimes Israel takes credit, sometimes it doesn't. But Israel is conducting what they call their war between wars, WBW, which is basically this campaign to stop these Iranian weapons from getting into the hands of Hezbollah before it's too late. And so when I watch Syria, I just watch for the explosions, quite frankly. I don't expect any political dynamics to change. What I expect is for Israel to target Iranian officers, Hezbollah officers, and Iranian-provided missiles. And this is, unfortunately, Israel's lot in life. This is the region as Israel sees it right now. Lastly, Russia. Look, Russia is, it's an interesting case for Israel because they're obviously in Syria and Israel needs to work with them to get what they want out of Syria, which is basically to continue to bomb it. And so what they do is they go to Russia and they've done it on a number of occasions and they will tell Putin, here's what I'm going to do. Here's what we need from you. We need you to stand down. We're going to attack things in this quadrant, and we want your people out of there so nobody gets hurt. And Putin, up until now, has been, the way the Israelis would describe it is it's not cordial, it's not friendly, it's professional. It's an understanding between two powerful countries that there are jobs to be done, militarily speaking, and the Russians respect the Israelis. A lot of people try to characterize this as a friendship. It's not. People try to say that Bibi is tight with Putin. He's not. That's not what's happening. What's really interesting, though, is I've actually talked to some of the people that have been in these meetings with Putin and senior Israeli officials. And the really funny thing is Putin will kind of, they'll do their business. And then all of a sudden, Putin kind of leans back and he does one of these, you know, and then he says, you know, I notice you're flying these crappy F-16s that the United States sells you. Why don't you try one of my Sukhois? Just, you know, take it for a test drive. You'll see we're great and with weaponry. And by the way, we're great allies. And, you know, they're constantly trying to pull the Israelis out of the American orbit. And they're doing the same thing with all the other countries in the region. But the idea, though, and I'll end here, is that, you know, I hear a lot of people talk about Russia as a rising superpower, a resurging superpower. All of the Russia analysts that I know, all of the specialists, all the Russian speakers, the people who follow that region, will say the same thing. And that is that Russia is a weak country with a weak hand, but they're playing it well. This is not a country that is destined for greatness. It is near collapse economically. They are a shambles internally, politically, but Putin continues to play these weak hands and we don't challenge him. And my hope anyway is that we call him out if he tries to meddle in our election in November. My hope is that we call out those that have worked with him, that we continue to embarrass him and weaken him on the world stage, because that is what is needed and we haven't done enough of it.
Thank you. Let's switch geography a little bit. We have a question about China and its growing influence in the Middle East. And with the U.S. deterioration in its relationship with China, how do you think that's going to impact Israel?
It's a terrific question, and I will tell you that it's what a lot of think tanks like mine are grappling with right now, those that are committed to ensuring a strong U.S.-Israel relationship. Look, what I can tell you is that Israel did what the United States and many other Western countries did for many years, which is draw closer to China. China has cheap labor. China has cheap products. China has, you know, companies that have grown into major multinationals, and their stock prices have soared. You know, there are countless authors and analysts out there that will tell you that the only way to make money in today's world is to have these kinds of relationships with China, or to buy these stocks, or to have them in your mutual funds or whatever. Israel bought into that just like the United States did. And what Israel also did is they began to engage in some joint ventures. And that's actually where I start to get a little uncomfortable, because what they started to do is to provide some technology to the Chinese. Now, the Israelis have been very careful about military technology, but in today's day and age, artificial intelligence, quantum computing, edge computing, autonomous vehicles, biotech, things like that, all of this stuff has some potential military application. And so the Israelis are providing possibly some things that the Chinese need for other uses. And that's where the United States is really uncomfortable. Also, the U.S. has grown uncomfortable about some of the infrastructure deals that we've seen between China and Israel. As you probably know, the Chinese bought the rights to administer the Haifa port, very close to where the U.S. Navy docks. They bought the rights to dig tunnels for the Israeli metro that will go very close to the Israeli Kiryat, their Pentagon, their headquarters for the Ministry of Defense. So all these things have made the United States uncomfortable. But I will say this, that the discomfort has come really since 2017, 2018. That's when the policy shifted. And what we've been advising the U.S. government to do, because obviously we want to keep Israel in America's orbit. We need Israel to be the friend that it has been, and Israel needs the United States. What we need to do is to figure out how to decouple slowly. It cannot be done overnight, because China represents 10 or 15% of the Israeli economy on some level, and that is just unsustainable for the Israelis to just pull the plug. You can't do it. So what we're talking about right now with the Israelis is, here's what you have to do now. Here's what you have to do next. Here's what you maybe don't have to do, and you can wait. But in the meantime, we're talking to the United States about direct foreign investment and finding alternatives to China, like India, Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, you name it. And by the way, an idea that I floated in Newsweek, I guess it was a few months back, is, you know, maybe we can resurrect the, I don't know if you guys remember the QIZs, the qualified industrial zones that Israel used to have with Jordan and Egypt, joint business ventures that allowed for some of these poorer countries like Egypt and Jordan to make products that ultimately went through quality control in Israel and then were sent to the United States and around the world. What if we did that with medicine? What if we did it with biotech, right, where the Israelis could really oversee and, by the way, help some of these economies? This is the kind of thinking that we need to be engaging in right now as that shift is taking place. And I'll also just maybe end with this, that Israel will likely serve as the model for a lot of these other countries that are going to be asked to do very similar things. The U.S. has gone to Israel first as an ally, and the Israelis have an opportunity to show people, to show other countries how you do it right. And we're trying to talk to them about exactly that.
Thank you. We have time for one more quick question. What do you think was Jared Kushner's role in the UAE agreement?
A fascinating question. You know, it's funny. I had a meeting lined up with him once at the White House, and it was a terrible experience for me because the secretary or the whoever it was forgot to give the White House my social security number. So I sat outside in the scorching heat last August while I waited for them to wave me into the building. And it never happened. And I went back to the office drenched and very frustrated. Okay. So that was my experience with Jared Kushner. But what I would say is there was a really interesting debate that was taking place inside the Trump administration in the last several months. You had Ambassador Friedman, the U.S. ambassador to Israel, who was advocating very stridently for annexation. He was the guy who was the voice behind this. He was pushing for it. He was saying that this was the opportunity for Israel. It was the best thing for them. They have to do it now because, you know, who knows what will happen to Trump after this. And Jared Kushner, who, you know, I would say is often, you know, maligned in the media, he was the one who was pushing for this more regional approach, that outside-in approach that I mentioned. And he won the day. And look, there were many other people that were intimately involved in this. You know, that you had, you had the Emirati intelligence services and the political class. You had the Israeli intelligence services and the political class. You had grassroots organizations and Track 2 and think tanks, and everybody was involved in this. But I will say that Jared's vision for this was the one that won out. Now, I'll say this, that Israeli officials have told me that it didn't matter who was going to become president, who was going to be in the White House, for this kind of progression to evolve, that the Arab states were gravitating to Israel anyway. But, you know, look, history is all about the leaders who understand the opportunities that are afforded to them. And in this case, I think we have to give some credit where it's due, maybe not all the credit, but at least some. He did the right thing and he capitalized on it. My question is, how many more can he get done before November? That's the trick.
Well, Dr. Shanzer, you are a wealth of information and knowledge. We could go on and on for hours, but we have promised that we would end on time at 8:00. Thank you so very, very much for being with us today. Dr. Ross, thank you so much. And I again want to acknowledge our partners, Stand With Us, and the Raleigh Carey Jewish Council for Community Relations. I think I got that right. And the Jewish Federation of Durham and Chapel Hill. And thank you all. And we hope maybe there'll be an opportunity for you to come back and speak with us again, Dr. Shanzer.
We'd love in person.
Great. We'd love that too. And want to remind everyone about our upcoming program on September 13th. With the IDF and talking about No One Left Behind, how the IDF uses the special skills of people with challenges in the IDF. So we hope we'll see you all again. Thank you so much and have a good evening, and everyone be safe.